What's going on, ladies and gentlemen? It's your boy Jordan, and we're back with the B3FL official podcast. Whoa, what a week. Week 10 was. We had some big games this week. I'm going to get into it. There's a lot to get over today. We had the release of the power rankings. That was big news. We have some very key matchups coming down the stretch, so we're going to get into all of that in a quick sec. Let's do this. We had the matchup of the week last week that was featured on our primetime game of the week was Connor's Quinnell Quicksand versus Papa T's Papa T. Excellent game. I'll pull up the scoring. Papa T was able to topple Connor 104-81. He was led by his strong core of running backs, Jonathan Taylor, Austin Eckler, Leonard Fournette, and even has Eli Mitchell sitting on the bench. That was the core of his strength, and he rode it right into the finish line. Connor basically stood no chance. He had a little bit of a blip, and then that was about it. He really lost production in terms of his running backs are just not as good. Cordarrelle Patterson's there, but he's missing Joe Mixon. But he just couldn't keep up with Papa T this week. Was not even close. Didn't have a chance. The dude just sucks. So this has massive implications for the standings as we go through some of the games. I'll show you the standings at the very end. But this essentially leveled out the playing field a little bit. Connor was 6-3 going into it, and Papa T was down 5-4. So now this puts them at equal. And so we'll get through some of the other games because there was way more upsets than just this one. Huge week for in terms of the underdogs. They're all coming through. Huge game from Zach Tickle, Yokiro Taco Bell. He lit it up against Tom's spread cheeks. Tom has been, he's now at 8-2. He's shown that he's vulnerable. The teams are coming out to play against him. They're bringing their A game, and Tom has just been sucking it. He just hasn't been doing it. Now he has a lot of injuries, a lot of guys, you know, not playing. So maybe that affects him going down the stretch. But Tom, dude, 120 points. You know you're the champ. You've got the target on your back. You can't keep this up. There's week 11, 12, 13. There's four games left. 11, 12, 13, 14. 14 is the last. And then we get into playoffs. Week 15 is playoffs. And I think I made a mistake last week. I thought week 15 was still regular season. It's not. There's four games left. And you got to bring it. Otherwise, you're going to sacrifice that number one seed. There is a chance that you also get knocked out of playoffs. So we'll talk about that in a little bit. The last game I want to go over too is the Lambeau Leap Squad, Ty Wary. He was in second place and looking like a true favorite to go all the way down with Tom right to the bitter end of right for the championship. But he's also fallen off now. He's lost two straight. He was 6-2. Now he's 6-4 and lost to a dominating performance by the Lords team. Ryan Lang, he got called out last week and he has come to show that, you know, don't take him lightly. He might score 140 points on you any given week. So congrats, Ryan. Congrats, Zach. And congrats, Papa T. You guys made it happen. You needed wins. You got it done. Let's look at the standings really quick and like look at the playoff picture. So right now, the divisions, I don't think we're going to be doing them. I think I can say that almost confidently. We're not doing divisions in the other guys' league. Just doesn't make sense with seven teams making playoffs. So the top seed right now, Tom, you are 8-2. But we have a bunch of guys down here following you. So with four games left, you actually are guaranteed to make playoffs. That's a lock. However, technically, Connor, you are not locked in. Papa T, you're not locked in. No, none of these teams are locked in. But it's making it a really interesting race because now we've got all these teams 5-5, 6-4, and it doesn't matter really as much where you fall in terms of those rankings. However, it is absolutely critical. It's absolutely critical that that the spread that Tom keeps winning, because if he starts losing, he'll fall into this pack, and anybody then it would be anybody's race. He loses, I think, one more game over the next. If he loses this week's game, it's on. The game, it has begun. So we're gonna be looking into this game. We're gonna be watching it very, very closely, because it'll be huge implications in terms of who moves up next year. So that's all I have for the Farm League. Quick recap, not many games, straight to the point. Underdogs prevailed. Everybody's in the mix now. It looks like it's going to be a fantastic finish to the end of this year. So we are going to move into a interview with Papa T. So make sure you guys stay tuned, and we'll get Papa T right on the line. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. I am here with the owner of Papa T himself, Terry Sterling. Papa T, how's it going tonight?
Hi, Jordan. First of all, before we get into this kind of dialogue, I just wanted to say, long-time listener, first-time caller.
I love that. I'm glad that everybody's tuning in. So we're happy to have you on the show. Your team has been red hot lately. You've won your last two games and had a big win this weekend over Connor Pico in the Quinnell Quicksand. How good did that feel winning that game?
Remind me again, Jordan, who did I just beat this weekend?
Connor Pico.
Connor. Oh, that's the one of the authors of the power rankings, right?
yeah, those power rankings.
See if he still fudges it to put his team on top of mine after I just beat him, thumped him this past weekend.
Yeah, you crushed him last week. It was the you won by over 20 points, which was huge.
And I sat my team for the second half.
Yeah, I saw that. Basically, just flatlined after 4 o'clock on Sunday. But. I want to get into your team a little bit. You've got a really solid team here. Who do you think has been your best player this year?
Well, I think like everybody would say, it goes up and down from week to week, and it goes up and down with teams that your teams match up against. But I think undoubtedly, Jonathan Taylor has probably been my best player. Most consistent, kind of in the 20 point a week range. Eckler has been close second, but I got to say also, for those who aren't familiar with my team, Rodgers has been a boom and bust kind of guy. Whether it's been COVID being out for, or in week one when I played Tom, he got me a total of 1 point. Can you imagine? I don't think Aaron Rodgers even had 1 point when he was sitting on the bench behind Brett Favre. So Tom, just so if you're listening, I'm gunning for you. I play you the last week of the season, and that game could be for number one. So you better tell your guys to get in shape.
Yeah, he's definitely listening. He'll be taking notes. He's going to circle that on his calendar.
Well, and also just the math, if he ends up losing one more, that game at the end of the season will be for first place.
Yeah, right. Well, we're looking forward to that. I guess, like, switching gears, who's been your least, or who's been their biggest disappointment this year?
Well, I don't know about your division, but I drafted Allen Robinson from Chicago pretty high, I think like fourth or fifth round, and the guy just compared to what he did, you know, previously in his career. He would get me 5 to 7 points tops.
Yeah.
So he no longer is a Papa T team member. But he would have been the biggest disappointment for me from my receiving core. And again, for Aaron Rodgers, pretty consistent, other than a couple weeks in there that he's had, the very first week in particular, 1 point. And in a week that I lost to Tom by 11 points.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
And I guess everyone has those stories, but that's my story, is saying Allen Robinson first for Chicago, drafted high and really never lived up to expectations, whether that's a play selection by the OC or whether that's just the quarterbacking issues. But he would have been my number one. My other thing that I would say was, I'm really pleased with his Fournette, how great a year he's having.
Yes.
Probably at the expense of Jones, but he's right in there with Taylor in terms of, he's like, I think, fifth running back. And with Eckler and Taylor, I got three of the top five, and that's including Henry, who's now out. So I got three of the top four running backs.
Yeah.
So that's where my strength is.
Yeah, looking at your strength, you have depth through your running back position. You even have Eli Mitchell on your bench.
Can't find a spot for him. And I had, maybe he's listening, is the fellow that's out in Halifax. I even felt sorry for him, so I traded him Hunt for Lockett. Otherwise, I would have had, when Hunt comes back in week 13 or week 12, 13, 14, I would have had like five running backs. And where do you put to have Mitchell and Hunt both on your bench because you don't have a spot for them?
Yep.
Nice spot to be. And with that, nice segue, Jordan, because now I'm putting it out there for anyone in the B division, anyone who's looking for a running back, always open to fair and equitable trades. Maybe you can say, I don't know if you're going to ask me about trades, but I got a few comments to make on the trades, at least for the B division.
Yeah, I've heard that that the B division has had some questionable proposed trades. Connor Pico has been on the show, and he said that I think maybe Liam or Ryan were the most ridiculous traders that he's ever seen. Have you experienced anything like that?
Probably not as much, but I got to say that one of the trades I was in, proposed trades I was in, I had wanted a receiver, a top-notch, top-five receiver from another team, and I was willing to give up a fairly good combination of running backs, and it must have gone back and forth about four times where the other GM only wanted Taylor from my team, and I would come back and say, no, how about this, and I changed the combination. They come back and say, Taylor. I changed the combination again. They come back and, Taylor. How many times do you need to be said no to? It's almost like in the B League, the guys want to wear down the other GM by saying, proposing a trade that they're not interested in, thinking that eventually we'll say yes. So it's just inexperience. I think the fact that you guys in the A division probably know a lot more about trades. In the B division, I find we're a little more inexperienced. Same like trying to, and I'm gonna name call to maybe get him on the show next week for you. But I look at the guy who's in first place in our division, Tom, offers me Chubb, who was out, and the backup running back to Cleveland when I had Hunt for Taylor. And I'm looking and saying, do I really need three running backs from the same team? Now, granted, Cleveland's not a bad team, but three running backs from the same team when in week 13 they all have a bye. You know, it's kind of that. But until they get the mentality of win-win and saying, if I can better my team and give up something that I can afford to give up, and if it betters your team, then it's a win-win. And that's kind of the success in everything. If you can come up with a win-win, then there's going to be more deals made, and you'll better your team. The other guy betters their team, but no one's going to lose, not better their team for charity.
Yep. Yeah, I think that's a good point. I do think that trading is usually, you try to make win-wins. Some people will try to make it so that way they have like a definitive one-sided win, and they try to rip the other person off. But
I know you look at the pros, and sometimes you question some of the trades that go on, but some of that is also salary caps and salaries that come into play, which we don't have to worry about.
Right. Yep. Yeah. So, yeah, it's complicated. There's a lot to trading. It's a lot of mind games too. So, there hasn't been a lot of trades in your league. So and your team has been faring fairly well. So, hopefully you'll be able to continue this momentum moving forward, regardless of whether the deals went through or not.
Yep.
But, so we've got, 5 games left before playoffs. Is there any message you want to send out to the managers as before we close off the call?
Well, it's going to be a horse race right to the end. I know there's only 4 games left, and it appears that some teams are already locked in. It's too bad because I think there's a couple of teams at the bottom that it's going to be really tough for them to make playoffs. But it's going to be now a matter of the top 7 teams, maybe top 8 teams, figuring out where they finish in the hierarchy. But it's now all about making changes to your team to get ready for playoffs, I think.
Yeah.
At least in our division. I think the 7 or 8 players or teams are probably set. But it's going to be a matter of not where you're going to finish the season. It's going to be getting your team ready for the first and second week of the playoffs.
Right. Awesome. All right.
Okay. Great to talk with you. I want to just say, before we go, one more thing. I want to go say hi to my mom and say, Mom, miss you and love you.
I'll make sure that we send it to Baba.
Oh, we're not on camera. Oh, we're on the radio. Oh.
Yeah. So, all right. Well, thanks, Papa T. Thanks, Dad. It's good talking to you again. Hopefully we'll have you back on the show soon.
You bet. Thanks, Jordan.
All right. Thanks.
Yeah. Take care.
All right. So that was Papa T, owner of Papa T, talking about Papa T, in the farm league. So let's move into the championship league, where we had a massive upset last week. We can go to the number one seed, the former number one seed, I Chase Young Kids. Matt Daly lost to Mike Bell in a, I guess, kind of disappointing fashion. Matt only scored 60 points, not even 60 points. That's a low. Basically, everybody just didn't do well, literally across the board, except for, I guess, Travis Kelce. He had a good game. But, less than 10 from your quarterback, neither of your running back, nobody breaks 10 except for Travis Kelce, essentially. Like, you're not going to win any games with that performance. Luckily, he got it out of the way. Moving forward, he can just keep going. He's still sitting really well. He's got a really high winning percentage. So it won't affect him that much. Kind of sucks that you've given Omar the clear number one seed in the league, because we know why. We all know why. But so Mike, congratulations, man. You're 4-6 now. Coming onto the podcast last week might have helped you. You ended up winning. So maybe you should come back more often, start complaining about your team, because they all kind of seem to just pitch in just enough to win this game. You had a little bit of a cushion, but Calvin Ridley, piece of shit. Miles Saunders sucks. And then you were hit with 3 byes last week. So looks good. Your team performed excellent compared to what it normally does. So good job, Mike. Way to take out the number one champ, or the number one, the king, former king. So Matt, you gotta try a little harder, dude. Like, this is not okay. You can't expect to go into playoffs with this. But we'll move to a team that has this is a roller coaster of a team in Robbie Peart. This man has gone from the highest highs to the lowest lows. He has rebounded in a very big way against Dan, beat hard. Dan was second in the league in scoring this week, and Jake still managed to upset him. So huge, huge win to move up to 5-5. Dan, you moved down to 4-6. You had a lot of momentum coming for you, but you played well. 116 points is nothing to laugh at, but Jake just really gave you the business there. Totally upset you. So that was crazy. I couldn't believe that he was able to do that. So congrats, Jake. Good game. Looking forward to seeing what you can do moving on into the later weeks and into the final stretch before playoffs. So let's look at the playoff picture. Okay. Top four teams in each division make playoffs. I'm going to just do one of these. Boom. Top four teams in each division make playoffs. So there is a very tight race here, I think, with four games remaining. It's actually, I mean, anybody technically could be out here, except for, yeah, I guess technically Omar could probably lose too. So what's really interesting about this league is that there's no interdivision games left, which actually means that Omar could lose all four. Ryman could lose three. I could lose two. Jake could lose one. If Kalen wins all of them and Mike wins all of them, we would have a six-way tie for first and sixth, or whatever, however you want to do. So absolutely insane. Absolutely insane. This is going to be such a cool, interesting finish, considering that normally there's some interdivision games and that means that teams can jump ahead. So Omar's got like pretty much a stranglehold on this division right now, because unless, God forbid, he loses all of his games, it looks like that, you know, he probably won't get kicked out. I think if he probably wins, one more, I think it's guaranteed that he can't get kicked out, because he won't be lower than any of these teams with the six losses. So Omar, you win one more, you're in. So I love how this is gonna play out. It's interesting just because, like, you won't be able to bump up. So like, if I was playing Omar, if I beat him, it would count as a win for me and a loss for him. But that's not gonna happen. So it's actually kind of stressful to look at. So, and if we move down into the lower division, this is even crazier, because every single team is within like two games of each other. This whole league right now has come down to an extreme. It's a close match all the way through, top to bottom, both divisions. I'm very interested to see how this is all going to play out, and really hard to do like playoff predictions and road to victory, because, or like scenarios, it's like, oh, if this team wins and then this team wins, because everybody is so, so close. We're just going to have to play it by ear, see how it goes, because this could have, with no division games left, this could just be one division could win every game for the rest. And honestly, Division 2 has been very strong. The last couple of weeks, they've won well over majority of the games against Division 1. So as Division 1 is starting to show a little bit of weakness. Omar has been holding it down. Ryman has been holding it down. But the rest of us have kind of been slipping. Last week was the first week in a long time where Division 1 actually had more wins than losses. So good job, guys. I was not part of that. My team has been slipping. We have been slipping. So you've heard a lot less shit from me because my team's been sucked. My team sucks. We're it. This is it. I might need to change the name because after two straight losses, we're looking, and they were gross losses at that. So I love fantasy. This is great. So we're gonna get to who was on the air. Oh right. The champ, 7 wins in a row. We're gonna get Omar Gizas walks with us. We're gonna get him on the show. We'll ask him some questions. He's gonna be in the hot seat because he is now our true number one seed. So make sure you guys stay tuned, and I will get him on the phone. All right, fantasy football owners, I am here with the one and only Omar Yeezus. What is it? Yeezus Walk With Me? That's your team name? Yes, it is. How are you doing tonight, Omar?
I am fucking fantastic. I'm on cloud 9. I'm down here in Miami enjoying the heat and sun and enjoying these big wins. You know, I don't know what's hotter, the heat in Miami or all this hate I've been getting.
Oh man, we'll get to the haters in a second. But you've won 7 straight. Your team is hot, like hot, Miami hot. What's been your secret to winning 7 straight games?
To be honest with you, you know, everyone goes for, you know, the rock stars, the superstars. Everyone's like, oh, I want my Tom Brady. You know, you don't need a Tom Brady. What you need is consistent players. The players that are going to be, you know, giving you consistent numbers week in, week out, getting you good scores, you know, and you 10 to 15 points a week. That's all you need. You need that consistency. And, you know, that's literally all you need. And that's something that's been driven to me since I was a child back in North Carolina. Like, that, ever since daddy would tell me, like, you know what, boy, you need that consistency. And it worked out well for me this year.
It's true. I mean, your team's been winning. You're first in Division One, and you're tied for first. You're first overall now. You're the lone wolf at the top of the pack. Now you mentioned the hill. Yeah, you mentioned player consistency. Which player on your team do you feel like has really pulled through for you this year?
Really, like, you can't just single out one of them. You know, there's so many of them. Even with injuries, like, you know, Russell Wilson going down for me there. Same thing with Carson. Just having those two key players go down. Everyone else really, you know, stepped up. Like I said, consistency was key. Most of my players, for the most part, you know, they're consistent. 10 points a game overall, pushing me through. You have your odd player here and there. They'll have a, you know, standout game, get you 20, 25 points. But to be honest, there's like no real lone single standout. If you looked at my players, all their rankings, they're all in the 20s. Some of them in the 10s. no one that's actually a real standout. So that's the secret sauce right there. That's the, you know, that's the Colonel's secret spices.
Yeah,
you gotta find the consistency.
Right. I've heard some people call you basically the Bill Belichick, where there's no superstars on the team, but it just somehow you just keep winning games.
It's all about the strategy. Like, people forget that football is a strategy game. It's like chess. You gotta think ahead. You gotta look at your opponents, figure out who you're gonna be playing next, and stack your team to win. You know, sometimes, like, some people say, "Oh, Omar, why'd you choose so many players that got bye week at the same time?" They all got bye week at the same time. You throw away that one game, but you get that consistency throughout the rest of the season. Don't have to worry about no more bye games. Don't have to worry, oh crap, I don't have a wide receiver, I don't have a running back. You know that one game you're going to fuck up, but the rest of the season you're going to be a rock star.
That's true. So let's talk about your haters for a quick second, because I know you got a bunch, me included. Mm-hmm. What do you have to say to people who think you're only winning because nobody's been scoring points against you?
Well, here's the thing. If you brought the ball to come play and you didn't play, it ain't my problem. All right? Like, if you're a shitty GM and you can't score points against me, that ain't my problem. A win is a win. Doesn't matter if it's by an inch, by a mile, it's still a win. Right? So, not only that, though, I ain't even the lowest points against. You got more. You got other players that are lower than me. And not only that, you got other players that are close to me. So it's not like this league, you know, it's not like I'm 200 points behind everyone. That's true. But I'm still pretty close. I'm still pretty close, but you know what? Not my fault. Y'all dropped the ball and decide, I don't know, go get, you know, some Carolina moonshine and fuck around with your cousin when I'm playing this. It ain't my problem. Mm-mm.
Yeah, and I guess the other criticism that you often hear is people complaining about you auto-drafting your team. What do you have to say to people who talk about you auto-drafting and not managing?
All right, so you got a tool. You got to use it. I am not as smart as the guys that programmed auto-draft. I ain't no Bill Gates. I ain't no even Elon Musk. I ain't any of those fancy little, you know, white boys. I don't know the math. I can't do the math to figure out who's going to be good. So you auto-draft, you get what you get. And then you figure out through some trades, you do some readings, and then you're like, all right, bet my bench ain't that good. I'm going to trade some of these guys out for some new rookies, you know, some of those new outstanding stars that might get you some points. And that's still managing a team. Auto-draft is there for a reason. Somebody smarter than me put it there.
Humble words. Yeah. So, and then I guess lastly, I know your time is precious. So, playoffs is in, I think there's 5 games left, 4 games, something like that. What's your outlook moving into playoffs?
I think the team's going to still remain consistent. We're still going to be consistently scoring, you know, 100 plus. We do have some tough games ahead of us, but as we've shown time and time again with a 7-game winning streak, that we deliver. You know, we the FedEx of this league. We always deliver, no matter the weather, no matter what. So that's my outlook. We gonna deliver.
Awesome. All right. Well, you heard it here first. This man is UPS. He delivers.
We FedEx. FedEx. No, UPS, that's too brown, you know. I can't don't go well with my skin tone.
Oh, of course. The caramel latte skin color is a little too much. So, all right, thank you, Omar, owner of Yeezus Walks with us. It's great having you on the show. Hopefully we can get you back on pretty soon.
Most definitely. Thank you. Appreciate you. I appreciate you.
All right. One love, dude. I'll talk to you later.
Peace, brother.
All right, guys and gals, we have a very special guest, Tom Vanuk, and he is here to talk about power rankings and spreadsheets. This dude is a G when it comes to spreadsheets. Hi, Tom. How are you?
Pretty good. How are you? Good, thanks for having me on the show again.
Well, you definitely earned it this week. There was a power ranking that was released this morning. And you said, fuck it, it's shit. I can do better. So I want you to kind of just walk through your process and in what was the driving factor behind making your new power ranking sheet?
You know what, when Jaron Connor announced their initial power rankings, they were talking about factoring in like points for breakdown, their wins, all these things. And you know what? When I heard it, I'm like, you know what? That sounds perfect. That sounds exactly like what it should be. I'm not going to question it. And, you know, they came out with the rankings and they seemed pretty, they didn't seem that off. So I was like, okay, I'm fine. But this morning, there was release of, the mathematics behind how these power rankings were calculated, and that's really what kind of set me off on a warpath. I think we were promised something and we didn't get it. We got some wacky standard deviations, normalizations, some crazy formulas, and I'm like, you know what? Maybe this works, maybe it doesn't. But, you know, I over the years, I've learned that simple is usually better. And so I figured I'd kind of make something that, you know, we were initially promised when Jaren Connor announced their power rankings. And I think I've kind of kept the spirit of it and kind of recreated it.
That's true. So I guess I'm looking at the spreadsheet now. So can you explain what goes into each person's power score? Or like how it's derived?
Yeah, of course. Maybe if you can scroll down to from row 34 to perfect. This is the right screen to look at. So essentially, kind of what I did is, hey, what statistics can we collect, and what have we been collecting so far? So those kind of variables are total points for your, and then you can split the points for from a average weekly score, a highest points this whole season score, lowest points you've scored, and then from a wins perspective, there's your actual wins and then your breakdown wins, which I always like kind of breakdown wins because it illuminates the factor of strength of schedule, which at the end of the day, I do agree that, you know, a win's a win, but it's nice to see that, hey, you know, if I played everyone else, over the season, my team would have performed X versus everyone else. So I took those, really two variables and manipulated them into six variables. and then it came down to, okay, how do you weight these variables? And you know what? I went with the good old arbitrary 50-50. 50 points to score and 50 points to wins. And then I kind of distributed them. We're just for the audience, we're looking at the top right corner of the screen right now. Basically, I distributed, and this is arbitrary, and, you know, we're going to have chatter, but, oh, well, you know, maybe it should be 27 points for points four, not 25. And look, I get it. But this is the one I created, and it's the one that's going to stay. It's too bad.
I was going to say, because I kind of baited you into it. I knew as soon as that these were published, I was like, oh, Tom is not going to enjoy this at all. So I was secretly hoping that you would put together some cool thing. And honestly, this would have taken me years, but it took you like 30 minutes. Not 30 minutes. You put in a lot of time. I watched you all morning, basically. I didn't do any work because I was just watching you work. But
you know, they don't call me spread cheeks for nothing.
So,
but yeah, essentially, out of 100 points, just scroll down a little bit, just so I finish explaining. Essentially, out of 100 points, we're distributing these points amongst those six factors. Then what's happening is we're taking a percentile where you are in the percentile of everyone else. And this is done per league because each league is different. So you're ranked by how you are doing relative to your league. So let's take, for example, the total points for Jordan. You have the most points for, and it's by a reasonable margin compared to everyone else. So you're being rewarded for that. Where the lowest points for in this league is who is it? Mike. So Mike in this category is not getting any points, rightfully so, because he's way off. He's almost 300 points off you, right?
Yep.
And then everyone else fits in between that. So like an example, like Ryman. Jake. Jake's pretty close to you, so he deserves to have almost as much points as you in this category. Where someone like Eric or Marty, they're on the more lower spectrum and probably don't deserve any of these points. And they're basically, how I think about it, this is the most fairest way to allocate these points. And then that's basically how it's done for each of these categories.
Okay.
And then, yeah, basically that's multiplied by the weighting to it. And that's how out of 100 total power score points. This is kind of how it's calculated. And then each week it will get updated. It'll get changed. So your average total points will change. Your highest or lowest score might change. Your breakdown will change, and that will get updated. And you'll get a kind of a better understanding of where you sit in the kind of rankings. Mm. And we did that for Farm League as well. So now if you scroll up, this is basically the big breakdown. And I added a little extra element. So we're going to look at the left side of the screen right now. The combined league power rankings. So essentially, these are all the scores from each of the different leagues combined. And because it's done per league, it's a fair representation of how these categories influence all the players on a more normalized basis. And then I added a little bit of kind of like a tier list to add. It's the classic internet tier list. You got S tier players, you got A tier, B tier, and you know, all the way down to F tier. And this kind of just gives you a sense of where each player kind of sits in different tiers. Because I would say that, hey, everyone in B tier are probably very similar to each other, even though they might differentiate slightly in a points for perspective or wins one or two plus or minus one or two wins. I would say they all kind of are in similar tiers. And that's kind of how you I would assume most people think about it when they're even drafting in fantasy. So yeah, that's kind of how to look at the numbers. And then I kind of have also on the right side a breakdown of the rankings from a Champions League and a Farm League. So just so everyone can see how they rank between each other in each league, respectively. And then for you, Jordan, and anyone else, I've also added a little tab in the middle that kind of that plots out kind of the progression of each player. So there's a little drop down menu. You can see kind of how everyone's power ranking has changed week by week.
Yeah.
So yeah, this is a great example. Terry, he started the season off very poorly. He lost against me, so it can't get any worse. but really, he's had a meteoric rise since then, and there's no other way to kind of chart that than the power rankings. So yeah, this kind of represents that. And you know, now there's managers in this league that will say, well, there's no future indicator in this, and while I agree that there isn't, I think as you introduce that factor, it becomes more subjective, and people might say, "Well, I disagree." But what's more better than to look at is to look at, let's say, this chart for Terry and say, "Hey, he's on an upward trajectory. There's nothing." I would say he's pretty hot right now. Every week he's doing better. He's improving his team. Maybe it continues. Maybe it doesn't. We don't know. I'll let the analysis be done by some of our more experts like yourself, Jordan, to determine who's totally gonna.
I guess
better or not. Yeah.
Yeah. This looks fantastic. I love the tier rankings, the breakdowns. So I think by the end of the year. Because we're starting to get pretty close there. Do you expect that these power rankings are able to change a lot, or is most of this already determined because we've had so many weeks?
You know what? Everything can change. Injuries can happen. You might have been if you're on the top on the list right now, all it's saying is you've performed so far very well. Is it factoring in injury that happens next week? No, but none of us can factor that in. So, your team could be I would say this list could change drastically.
Okay.
But I think it gives a good sense of, I think we're 2/3 into this season. I don't see it changing much. Maybe the F tier and E tier might swap around a little bit, but I can't imagine the I think the people in the S tier will likely probably stay there.
I think so too, Tom. Speaking as the two S tier play owners, I think we're the best and everybody else is shit.
It's I would say it's not even close. Sucks to suck. So.
We smoked them. So I can't wait for everybody else to realize that, you know, we did two power rankings and both times Tom and Jordan came on top. So this is great.
You know what? There's something in the water here in Toronto that we're just built different.
Yeah, we breeds fantasy football owners.
Yeah, you know what? Omar drinks the same water, and you know I'd like to say he's been doing a really great job somehow.
Yeah. Somehow. We don't know how.
Now you see the power rankings are given that, you know, even though he's been winning a lot, his actual points haven't been given him enough kind of, you know, credit, and the power ranking factors that in. So I think it's a fair assessment of where he lies in the
that's true,
you know, order of things.
That's absolutely true, because he's beaten some really good players. So and I do think that this gives a much better, more well-rounded. So, I think that's all my questions. Was there any owner that you were like, wow, I can't believe they either ranked so low or ranked so high? I don't know if you had a chance to look at it, but
you know what? I started on this warpath because I saw Zach Tickle higher than me, and you know, I couldn't. I think it was a Pico ranking. That where is that? Maybe pull that up.
Yeah, he's third.
You know, it was a bittersweet loss last week, and I think his team shit, and he just got lucky. So there's no fucking way his team's better than mine, and you know I have stats to prove it. So, you know, I still lost fair, but there was some. I knew something was off when I saw this.
Yeah, I figured that. I figured as much. As soon as I saw your name at fifth, I was like, "Oh, he's gonna want to redo this power ranking." So, awesome. Well, I think that's all I have. Is there anything else you wanted to touch on?
No. Thanks for having me again.
No problem. We'd like to have you on the show. Now that you're the reigning champ, there's lots of people coming for you this week.
You know, there is a lot of people coming, and I'm feeling it. I'm feeling the pressure. This league has really tightened up in the second place category. There's a four-way tie. So, definitely, Jer made everybody kind of put a target on me, and fair enough. And I definitely feel like there's definitely a target on me right now, and. Well, let's bring it on. Let's see what you guys got.
All right. Welcome. This man welcomes competition. So, all right. Well, thanks, Tom. Good luck the rest of the year if we don't get you on the show again, but we definitely will.
Thank you.
All right. I'll talk to you later, dude.
See ya.
Bye. All right. So that was Tom. Thank you, Tom, for showing up on the show. Big help. Love the power rankings. I am interested to see if Connor would do a breakdown of his. So we will move forward into the awards section of the show. And so we're going to start with the high voltage player of the week. And this could be two people. The first one is Yokiro Taco Bell. He whooped Tom, laid a smackdown, gave him a run for his money. Man, was that a beatdown? He definitely,
got him.
Got him this week.
Got him.
That was Yokiro Taco Bell. Yeah. Smackdown on Tom. Love to see it. Love when the number one team gets kind of upset, unless it's me. But yeah, and the other player is someone who we haven't talked a lot about, was Robbie Purr. he's been kind of absent after he kind of fell off. Yeah, I mean, he did beat Dan. He beat hard Dan. I don't know if it's as big. I don't like the gaps about the same, 20-ish point gaps. The averages, Robbie Purr was much higher than, he was about 40 points higher than Yokiro Taco Bell. So, does that mean Robbie Purr is our Shockwave Player of the Week? Yes, it does. Absolutely, it does. He was just that much higher. He almost scored the same, and despite having a non-PPR league. So, I have noticed that the High Voltage Player of the Week has usually gone to the Championship League. And it usually depends on how far you are from the average is what I just usually use as a metric. However, maybe it's just because there's more people in it that there's a likelihood of getting way, way higher. It's just like there's just more people. So I will have to reconvene with some of my analytics experts. And we're going to talk about maybe ways to revamp each award at the end of the year. But for now, for consistency's sake, Robbie Purr, you are the Shockwave Player of the Week. All right, and now it's time for one of my favorites, the...
What are you?
An idiot sandwich.
And we've got not one, but two Idiots of the Week, and these two buffoons played each other. We're talking about the Fantasy Fisters and Effort Wins. Let's go down to their team.
No.
Oh, these guys are dumb. So, okay, first we're going to talk about Fantasy Fisters. If there's two Idiots of the Week, this is a little bit less. He started Van Jefferson. Who? Van Jefferson? Never heard of this guy. He's the replacement for Robert Woods, who was hurt last week. The Effort Wins. He started Robert Woods. And that's a shitty spot. They played on the Monday. And he was like a game time decision. So you kind of got screwed a little bit here. I don't follow the Rams and Robert Woods' injury situation. So I'm not all privy to their information. But then you started who? Leo Jones? Dude, this guy hasn't done anything. But in all fairness, like it's like, okay, maybe in some realm, maybe these guys were supposed to play. I don't think so. I think 9 LA. Oh, he's on the IR now. Maybe. I'm not sure. Anyways, look. Ricky. Ricky, dude.
Shame.
Starting two players
Shame.
Who were out this week
Shame.
Is terrible. Especially when you have two kickers on your team. Dude, just drop a kicker, pick up a receiver. And based on what it looks like here, you're actually able to move an IR. I don't know if actually this league has IR spots. Either you move Schuster into the IR spot. That way it frees up a space on your bench so you can pick up another guy. Or you're just down a bench player. Either or, you got to figure this out. This is a mess. You know what? I was ashamed. I'm ashamed to say that I was promoting this team at one point. That you and Papa T were like rising through the ranks. I'm sorry. I made a mistake. Look, get your team in order. Tell them to stop goofing off and just get over it. Okay, look. And then, Fantasy Fisters, you got off lucky, bro. If we look at the league average, you were still below it. So, let's talk about something. You started Van Jefferson. I don't know who this guy is. And you left Antonio Gibson on the bench. This dude is a bona fide stud. You know what? This Ramondre Stevenson, maybe you'll get a pass. Yeah, he had 100 total scrimmage yards the game before, one off because his games before that were not very strong. He just had a touchdown. But you know what? 25 points, hard to argue with. And there's room for improvement. Look, yeah, Van Jefferson, not a bad call. But when you're leaving these guys on the bench, yeah, dude, you need to give your head a shake. Like, bro. So, look, these were my idiots of the week.
What are you?
An idiot sandwich.
And it's hard. Rick, my guy, just change your team, dude. That's all we got to do. You got to log in, like, what, Thursday night, Sunday morning, maybe Sunday night in case there's a Sunday night game, and Monday. You probably got to log in 4 times a week at minimum. Maybe 5. Sometimes I don't look at the Monday because I don't really care because it's whatever. But at the very least, look on Sunday and then look on maybe Thursday night too. But, oh, dudes, idiots. These guys, bunch of idiots. Oh, my God. All right. Like,
bruh.
Whatever. We're done. Okay. We're moving on. He's this walk with me. He's 8-2. He's leading the league. He's not very high in the power rankings. If we go to the power rankings here, he's not very high. He's number 7. But you know what? This guy puts up wins. And as everybody only cares about, that's the only thing we care about is wins. This guy is playing his heart out. Scrappy, hard-nosed football, winning games. You know, it's not easy being number 1 and everybody's coming for you, but he's doing his best to put up his best fight. This week, he's facing Jordan Ivany, a very mediocre team, middle of the road, but has a breath of new life picking up T. Higgins and Jonathan Taylor this week. So, facing a whole new team. Jordan gutted the core of the team, shipped him off to, I think, to Mike, to Jake's relegation, swapped it for Jonathan Taylor and T. Higgins. So, yeah, Omar, you've been good. You're going to continue. This is a win, I think, for you. So, you have a hot, well-earned, well-deserved. You've done great. Good job. You knocked off Eric, who was on here. So, great job. You've earned it right away. That's 7 in a row. I can't deny it anymore. I thought it was a fluke. But great job, Omar. Continue to keep up the good work. So. All right. So, ladies and gentlemen, I've got a
surprise, motherfucker,
for you. We've got a brand new segment starting this in this show. And it might only be one time. It might be forever. I don't know. I keep saying this a lot. But this is the chirp of the week. This week was off the hook. You guys on Sunday watching the Lions and Steelers game, crazy. That was fun. I enjoyed watching the Steelers fall and the Lions become one of two undefeated teams in the NFC in the month of November. Love to see it. That's what football is good there for. But we're gonna talk about the. Hold on, I gotta get the sound up. It's a chirp of the week. This goes out to whoever basically makes me laugh in the group chat and makes fun of other people. And there's a couple people. You know what? There's an honorable mention because it wasn't in the group chat. And I'm going to go over it. The first one is, I'm going to just read it right from here, is Matt Daly. We're talking about, he's like, when are you getting Lil D on the podcast? Dan, you got to get on here. We got to schedule a meeting next week. It's like, probably next week. He's like, yes, low-key, I was a little upset we did not name the Farm League the Lil D League in honor of Dan just being at the bottom of the barrel every year. What? What? That's unbelievable. Like, yes, Dan, you're at the bottom every year. Do you deserve to be picked on? Probably. That's a quality term. I love that one. I might rename it to the Dan League next year. But in all fairness, he's not there right now. Right now, it's looking like the Tom League because he's dominating it. But yeah, so the other one, this guy actually made me laugh out loud. And so the conversation goes like this. Jake goes, Victory Tuesday. Can't wait to hear Jordan talk about my greatness on there, the box suite. Dan is always a get right week. Thanks, fam. Or thanks, Dan. And Dan goes, your QB and defense scored half your points. Then Connor, oh God, my dude. He goes, you're both B League GMs. I laughed so hard. I went to Julie and I was like, Julia, you got to check this out. And she just looked at me. She looked at me like,
what are you?
An idiot sandwich.
Yeah. She thought I was an idiot sandwich. But I still think about this when I need quick pick me up. I think about that. They're both B League GMs. Oh dude, they got fucking roasted. Can I get a,
how are you?
That was awesome. Bravo, Matt Daly, Connor Pico, you guys earned it this week. That was just absolutely brilliant. Love to see what's going to go on this week. I can't wait for Sundays. This is awesome. So. Looking at this week's schedule, we have a ton of people who I actually think could upset. I actually think everybody in all of the favorites, so like everybody who has a higher record in the farm league, is going to be upset except for Tom. I don't think that Ricky is going to be able to beat Tom. But I believe that the large penis team, Yokiro, Tackle Bell, Lambo, Alpha Legion and the Lord's team all beat the other teams. I think it all is going to happen this week. Which game am I going to bet on? Quinnell Quicksand. I don't think you got it this week. I think Large Penis team takes it to you, snaps his 3-game losing streak. I think you're going to have a heck of a time this week. And I don't see you pulling out a win. I actually see you moving to 6-5. You're going to move to 6-5. That's going to be it. And you're going to fall further down the standings. You're going to add another loss to your win, right? But you're here to hear first that all of the lower teams will win except for Rick, because I don't know what's going on with his team, but he needs some help. That dude needs some help logging in. So, yeah. Connor? You're in the danger zone this week. Be careful, bro. I'm telling you, it's dangerous down there. It's crazy. So.
Ladies and gentlemen, and now for your prime time game of the week. We have a humdinger of a game. Two ex-roommates, Jer and Jake, battling it off this week. Jer is 5-5, Jake is 5-5. We have a head-to-head collision of the mediocre teams that hate each other. Jake is coming off a huge win, having the best score in the league last week, and Jer came off a very mediocre win. These two guys are going to be pumped this weekend. Jer is finishing his CFA, so I know he's going to drink a lot of drinks. I know my mom listens to this podcast. And Jake he's going to drink a lot of drinks because he's playing Jer. This is going to be a wild matchup of two very mediocre teams, and I can't wait to watch this go down. I am going to love every second of this. Hopefully we get a live stream of what they're going through if they're watching the game together. Anyways, my name is Jordan. This has been the B3FL Podcast. And I hope you've enjoyed this special presentation. Peace!